Our second one is in the faith we sing, number 2268, as we gather at your table. So then the teacher drew a few connecting lines, put in a few rests and a cleft at the beginning. It was easy to see then that the black dots took the form of a musical score. On sounding the notes, the pupils found themselves singing the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. No, that's not the doxology. But that's as close as I can get from an internet image. When we worship, we're trying to connect our life's disconnected dots. Daily living is made up of all these little this's and that's, small events and brief moments that occur now and then along the way. And often it's hard for us to see that these have any meaning, or if there is meaning, what it might be. In worship, we see God's eye, God's eye view of what we are. We seek to see ourselves as we are seen by Him. This is to see our life in perspective and in its entirety, not as a meaningless scattering of random dots on a blank page, but as a musical score that sings, "Praise God from whom all blessings flow." Then each new day of living, each little task becomes simply another note on our majestic song. So welcome to worship in the Oneida United Methodist Church this morning, where we seek to connect the dots of our lives, making them into a song we can sing together as we celebrate the lives of the saints who've moved on to be with God. Saints who've gone ahead of us and are there preparing a place for us so we can once again connect the dots of our lives together and sing a new song in praise of our Creator. Announcements. Let's see, they're on the back of your bulletin. Thanksgiving doesn't show up there, but it is November 28th. purchased some music for the choir to sing the Sunday before Thanksgiving, which is November 24th. Jesse and I would like to invite anyone who wants to sing in the choir to join us for rehearsals on Saturday afternoons, respectively the 16th and the 23rd. I also have two pieces of music for Christmas, so choir rehearsals can continue into the Saturdays of December. If you would be interested in singing in the choir, please let me know so I can get enough copies of the new music for everyone. Sharon and I will be on vacation. What is vacation? What is that? The last week in November. We're hoping to enjoy Thanksgiving in Virginia with our daughter Heather and son-in-law Chris. CJ will be preaching December 1st. So mark that Sunday down on your calendars so you can be here to enjoy CJ's preaching. The verse I want to bring to your attention is John chapter 11, verse 43. When he had said this, that would be Jesus, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!"
Yeah.
believe in God, Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God, our new beginnings, wipe away our tears, that we may come before your throne with hearts full of song and souls on fire. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die, so when our time to depart comes, we may go forth as those who are prepared to live. Whether living or dying, O Lord, our hearts will always belong to you. Amen. And our next hymn is number 711 in your hymnal. Well, like the guest is for all the saints.
Thank you. 25, verses 6 through 9. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Now, today's epistle comes from the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verses 1 through 6. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a voice, a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, see, I am making all things new. Also he said, write this, for these words are trustworthy and true. Then he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Now today's gospel reading comes from the book of John, chapter 11, verses 32 through 44. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, see how he loved him. But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead for 4 days. Jesus said to her, did I not tell you that if you believe, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me. And when he said this, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in cloth. Jesus said to them, remind him, and let him go. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
thoughts that Judith placed on my heart. The words. Just the right words for me as your people this morning. I think all of us like those things that are bright and new and shiny. Things like a new car with its special smell as we explore all the new gadgets and stuff that comes with new cars. Things that our older car wouldn't do. And maybe a new home. When you go in there and you can smell the fresh paint and all the walls are clean and the floors are bright and shiny. Sometimes these new things may not necessarily be any better than the items they are meant to replace. Consider this story of a three-legged chicken. Business people are always looking for that new, great product that will bring them instant success. Usually, though, there is a hitch. So a man was driving along when he happened to look out his window. An astonishing sight met his eyes. Running alongside the speeding car was a chicken. The fact that the chicken could keep up with the car was surprising, but that wasn't a big surprise. The thing that took the man's breath away was that the chicken had three legs. He pulled off at a local farmhouse to ask them about this amazing sight. When he described the chicken to the farmer admitted that it was his creation. Out behind our silo, we got about 5 dozen of them birds running around. We're raising them to sell to Kentucky Fried Chicken, the farmer explained. Wow, the man thought, you'll be making a fortune off these things. Not a red cent, the farmer answered. Ain't caught one of them. Just because something is new or different doesn't always make it better. For many of us, when we lose a family member or a friend or someone else to death, it's difficult, if not impossible, to find anything better about our new situation. For those who follow Jesus, the better is in knowing that God has taken what was lost and turned it into something new and better that awaits us, those of us who believe that God is the creator of the new heaven and the new earth. At All Saints, it is time to celebrate Christ's victory over death. The new and better thing we share with all the saints and our risen Lord. We must never think that this victory was an easy one. Death has an overwhelming power that interrupts our communion with God and with one another. It is the destroyer of all that is true and good. In the prophecy of Isaiah, Israel has known the power of death at work in a communal disaster. The disaster was the destruction of the city of Jerusalem, the place where they thought God resided. Their kings, anointed to be shepherds of Israel, had fleeced the ship, and those appointed to care for the welfare of the lowly had sought their own glory instead. Those who were supposed to be true to Yahweh played the harlot. The judgment of God was that a foreign military would destroy Jerusalem and the people were to be carried off into Exodus. Even in captivity, the Israelites knew that death was still holding power over them. The Babylonian captors were arrogant and ruthless, becoming the very epitome of a destructive dynasty in the eyes of the prophet. In the beginning of chapter 25, Isaiah anticipates the end of such dynastic death dealings. Prophet praises the Lord and says, "For you have made the city a heap, the fortified city a ruin, the palace of aliens is a city no more, it will never be rebuilt." 25 verse 2. Then comes the promise of a different city, of a new city. The promise begins with, "On this mountain." The mountain is where the Temple Mount is, this Zion city of God, the heart of all Judah. It is Jerusalem, built as a city bound firmly together, to which the tribes of the Lord could go up. It is Jerusalem, the golden city, running with milk and honey, blessed. That is a promise that for the Israelite people was this new city, this Jerusalem restored. After the restoration, the next move is to be a feast, a banquet. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, it says in verse 6, a sumptuous banquet, which is used as a symbol of what God planned for his people. The description of the food is, or the menu is time-honored, a feast of well-aged wines and of rich food filled with wine. But this banquet is to be seen as relief from the ultimate materialism of the old city, as nourishment for the whole person, as a Eucharist with God. It is a banquet of justice and peace and community. Occupancy of the new city is not to be restricted. It's not just for Israel, but for all nations. It says the Lord will make for all peoples a feast. All peoples, all nations, all faces. Clearly, the prophet is striving for an inclusive invitation that everyone is welcome in this new city. Then the image is broadened. In addition to the wonderful feast, it says, "And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all people, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever." Verse 7. In the Old Testament, death is overcome. That death which snatched away loved ones, which frightened us with its arbitrariness, which gloats over its finality, which leaves us cold and empty. Death which circumscribes life, which negates well-being, which limits our community with one another and with God. Isaiah promises that God will swallow up death like a great sea creature consuming a bait fish, or like a tiger effortlessly disposing of its prey. The Bible is fond of these images of leviathan-like sea monsters. Those are the very symbol of death. Destroying such a monster is what meets our promise here. The tables have turned. God has swallowed up death forever. That's the same image that was picked up by Paul in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 54, when he said, "Death is swallowed up in victory." The victory over death in the new and is the new and better thing that God offers to our people. So the point of our gospel reading this morning, John chapter 11, 32 through 44, is the raising of Lazarus. It is that God is working to do something new in Jesus Christ in order to destroy death and bring new life and immortality to the world. God invades the territory of death and snatches Lazarus back to show where the real power lays, but not without some honesty. Jesus said to Lazarus, unbound to the people, unbind him and let him go. The body of Lazarus had been wrapped in linen strips, liberally laced with spices according to Jewish tradition. Even the spices could not contain the corruption which death brought. Martha recognizes it, and she warns Jesus. He's been dead already for 4 days. By now, he stinks. That's the reality Jesus faces, the reality we all face. That is the bondage and power of death. But Jesus says, unbind him and let him go. The thing that was made new in the raising of Lazarus was only temporary. Certainly, Martha and Mary and her friends were all overjoyed to have Lazarus back with them. Sadly, and eventually, they all, even Jesus, must die. But the ultimate new was achieved by Jesus through his work on the cross and the empty tomb. He's not here. He's risen, the angel says. God has said yes to the cross and no to death. The cry with which Jesus calls Lazarus out of the grave is only an echo of the call which called Jesus to life, the first fruit. And it calls us forth too. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised, and we shall be saved. In the meantime, we live in hope. It is the new hope expressed in endlessly beautiful and challenging visions in the book of Revelation, as recorded by John from his dream. The first image is cosmic. I see a new heaven and a new earth, a restoration of all of creation, a return to paradise, a starting over. That new thing that brings us hope for better things to come. Then his dream continues. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, not the product of human efforts. For all of this newness is a gift directed from God. Then it is God who speaks from the throne. John recalls, I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. In verse 3. No longer does God reign as the Holy One in an unapproachable distance. Rather, God is now very nearby. God will dwell with us, and we will be God's people. Because death is no more, so mourning and crying and pain need not be with us anymore. For the first things have passed away. God is in charge and makes all things new and better. And Christ seals what is new with a promise, the promise of one who has conquered death. Write this, he says, for these words are trustworthy and true. It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. This is the promise of Jesus Christ, the promise of something very new, very different, and very wonderful for all people who believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, who died once and all for all our sins, and who has come to save the world. Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Unless you can think of more. So would you join me in the bold response at the back? Give us grace to follow the example of their steadfastness and faithfulness to your honor and glory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you continue with me this morning in an attitude of prayer? Loving God, we bless your holy name. We give you thanks for all the faithful servants who have passed away. Our lives have been blessed by their presence. We miss them. Yet we understand that they are with you in that holy city where pain and tears no longer exist. We have asked your love and care for those we have included in our prayers this morning. Provide healing for those who are ill or who are continuing to recover from illness and injury. We would ask your presence, especially with Patty Peters and with Jim Gold. We pray for comfort for those who mourn the loss of family, friends, neighbors, and co-workers. Hold those families in the palm of your hand so that they may find comfort and patience in your everlasting presence. Find those who lost their way in this turbulent world in which we live. Grant them courage and forgiveness so that they can return to you. We pause now for a few moments of silent prayer to bring our personal petitions directly to God's throne. Faithful Lord, bless us with your healing presence. Make us hungry for justice. Strengthen our faith and increase our love for others, especially those we find it most difficult to love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our last hymn is number 614 in your hymnal, For the Bread, which you have broken. Love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. And all God's people said, Amen.